Welcome everybody to this event, Blockchain for Social Change, which has been co-organized with by the University of Naples and Ledger Project in the person of Gavin, who's the only, and also Felix. There was supposed to be the introduction for a two-day workshop within the Ledger Project would offer coaching and startup help for a number of blockchain projects that they're supposed to incubate. But given the present situation with the Corona C panic, that has been cancelled, and we also moved the event from the university to here, as you might have noticed. The theme for today is blockchain and blockchain for social change. I guess you won't know about what blockchains are, since you're here. So there's really no reason to explain that, I guess, but my name is Adam Arvidsson, and I'm a professor in sociology at the Federico II, and we have with us in the panel, we have Giulio Quarta, who's from Padua, and is running an organization called the Connective, which is a collective or connective think tank on commons, digital economy, etc. Maria Caracalanoglu, who's our, I don't really know, remember where you're based now.
Maria Cristina.
Maria Cristina.
I'm based here in Naples, and I work in a European project.
Okay.
Barzun-based.
I'm sorry about that. I'm a very, very bad conference here. And Jaromil Denis Rokos in Amsterdam, and also one key figure in the Ledger project, and also a central figure in the blockchain world, etc. So Tiziana Taranova is a professor of digital, but not really a professor, but been sort of a classic in the analysis of cognitive capitalism, digital capitalism, etc. And Stamattia Portanova, who's just written a book on blockchains, which is about to come out, right? Or has already come out, or about to come out, yes. So basically what I'm going to do is, I'm going to just present a couple of slides, just 5 minutes, to show you a couple of results from a research that we're doing, research that we've done on blockchain technologies for social change. There's some very sort of preliminary and vague results right now, but the idea is just to give a little bit of a feed for thought on the things that we're going to talk about. So, basically there are a lot of blockchain projects, right? So we've tried to sort of get some sort of idea, we being Afi, who's just coming in here tonight, tried to get some sort of idea about how many there are and how many are actually active. And we started to try to compile a list of blockchain projects that were sort of self-confessed socially progressive, or mentioned by others as being socially progressive, or in some other way sort of dedicated to some sort of social or political or civic agenda. And sort of going through all the lists that have been published before, and going through all the blogs and the Twitter feeds, and trying to sort of peruse the internet as much as possible, we came up with about 150 cases, right? So we found about 150 blockchain-based projects which proclaim themselves to be socially progressive. By comparison, if you look at the commercial blockchain projects, there are about 60 projects that have a market capitalization of more than $10 million. There's about 1,000 projects that have a market capitalization of more than a million projects, etc., etc. Right? So in relation to the sort of commercially oriented projects, the number of progressive projects is significant but quite small. However, among those progressive projects, we found that out of the 150, only about 50 could be considered active, right? And what do we mean by active? What we mean by active, that they either show proof that they have users and do something, or, and both mostly the two things come together, that they have a token, a coin that is being traded and that has a market capitalization. And this is also fairly typical, because one of the impressions that I have, we have about the blockchain world having done this, is that there is a lot of sort of purely cultural production out there, right? There's a lot of blockchain ventures that are primarily oriented towards the creation of white papers or Medium articles or Twitter feeds or other things like that without actually doing much or without actually having a practical application, or will have a practical application perhaps in the future, but it's still not there, right? And this might be because the technology is mature, but it might also be because there is a certain interesting orientation towards the discursive production of scenarios for the future within this world. So looking at these 52 active projects, they're basically divided this way. The thing that strikes you here is that basically the most important sectors where blockchain for social change are active are the energy sector and what we call the rural sector. By the rural sector, we mean things like alternative farm economies or sharing of farm equipment or supply chains for alternative types of farming or things like that. Right? And these are also sort of, most of these projects are both sort of socially active, but also commercially active in the sense that most of them, about half of them, have significant, though not enormous amounts of money circulating in the coins that they have created. Another sector, funding and donation, is because what you have on the one hand, the very large market capitalization comes from the fact that both Binance and Dogecoin, which are two sort of fairly speculative cryptocurrencies, have automated donation functions. So they figure as sort of donation agencies. But the rest of them, and that's why there's so much money there, but the rest of the agencies are essentially old style Help the Children in Africa associations, the ones that used to send these advertisements for Christmas with the children, television, etc., which are now doing the same sort of philanthropic work, but they do it with blockchain. And those generally don't have any trade in their currencies, they just use blockchain because it's fancy or trendy or something like that, to basically do the things that they've always been doing. And then you have a number of other sectors which are basically, you know, fairly, the fintech sector, also the fintech sector is mostly, it's dominated by money transfer companies like BitPesa, for example, which is one of the largest ones. Technology sector, of course, there are a few organizations that the high market capitalization comes from the fact that Holochain has alone a market capitalization of about 120 million. And whether Holochain is active or not is, of course, a question that maybe we can discuss afterwards. But they have a lot of money, at least. And they have a lot of promise that they will do something. But if they actually do it or not is another question. So this is a bit the composition of, I mean, as I said, this is very preliminary. And then we did some very, very simplistic, basically just word cloud analysis of the descriptions of these companies, of their websites, just to get some sort of idea. And as you can see from this, the energy sector, there's a big focus on solar and renewable and alternative energies, of course, right? And it's also a sector which is focused a bit on trade, and it's organized as a market. So the idea is, of course, to use blockchain to create a market for alternative energy. When you gather electricity with your solar panels, and then you can sell that to or trade it with your neighbors or with something like that. And so it's a market-based organization of an energy commons. And this is also, in parentheses, something that is quite clear. We had a big research project on commons-based beer production a couple of years ago, and one of the most clear results from that was that most commons-based initiatives tend to adapt some form of market logic in order to organize what they do and their ventures. And finally, the rural economy is perhaps the most interesting one, because what you have here is something that it has to do with communities and soil, and it has to do with things like carbon capture. So there's, like, you can see a lot of the themes that have been echoing also in this sort of neo-rural sector, which is coming up. This is very much the sort of neo-artisan agriculture, high-quality, ecologically conscious sort of farms that are using blockchain, relying on blockchain to try to somehow reorganize their markets and their supply chains in a way that's sustainable. And maybe the sector also works best because, as you probably know, within the whole sort of galaxy of alternative economies, that new food economy is the one that is most sort of economically sustainable, also because there's a concrete commodity to trade and so on. And finally, the last slide, and as I said, this is very preliminary. We did a bit of a statistical topic modeling on white papers, just for the socially progressive ones. And what you can see, which is probably fairly expected, is that you have essentially three discursive clusters in the white papers. You have one, which is the one I marked with. You can't really see very well, but you have one which marked with blue here, which is the more sort of socially progressive one, which is marked by terms like community, carbon, climate, sustainable, impact, etc., etc. And then you have like a trade-oriented cluster, which is more oriented towards things like exchange and value, etc. And then finally, there is like what we could call an innovation or technologically oriented cluster, which is more oriented to things like, you know, innovation, blockchain, democracy, etc., etc. Which basically somehow is the promise of the technology itself. So then in the future, we'll try to do this research a bit better, and we'll also start looking at the database of commercially successful blockchain projects to see how these things compare and if there's some sort of meaningful similarities and differences. But that's not really what I wanted to discuss now. I just wanted to present a little bit these slides to give some sort of food for the discussion. And to be a bit provocative, this is maybe the question that I will launch towards the panelists. It's having done this research and looked at blockchain for a while, it seems to me that the blockchain's been around for about 10 years, but it's been singularly inefficient in creating anything useful, right? I mean, it's very good in creating a lot of imaginaries and ideas and visions for the future and grand scenarios, etc. But, you know, we still don't have any blockchain-based apps for decentralized Uber or anything like that, right? So is this just a question of time? Is it because you need more time to develop the technology, or is it something that's, or has it just been a gigantic boom of hype?
I believe that the main problem that hinders the realization of a lot of promises that the blockchain world gives is the fact that it's a very complex and hermetic technology. It has to do a lot with cryptography. It has to do with complex networking, distributed systems, and even for a computer engineer, like engineering distributed systems is a fairly complex task. And it's also a different paradigm from the usual, let's build a platform. Let's build a platform with a database, with data inside. Most engineers are used to think this way. And the data-centric paradigm is a novel paradigm. So, for instance, what we call in accounting science, REA, REA, which is Resource Event Agent paradigm, is a different way to build systems, which is more decentralized and basically offers a way to look at data the way you want. So often I try to make it easy for people to understand, whether I succeed or not, it's up to you to judge. Making a metaphor, but also describing it this way, in one way you have data in a database, so you will have data inserted in an Excel sheet or a database. But with the REA, you will have a pipeline, which is a pub-sub, so-called in engineering. So publish-subscribe pipeline, where people send events, and you can build your view. So you can subscribe to the events that you want. So it's up to you how much you want to store these events, how you want to analyze them. What you have is a common pipeline. Now imagine that this pipeline is not linear, but it's actually a peer-to-peer network. So there is a peer-to-peer network where data travels, and you can build your own way to look at this data. So you don't look at the data through the lens of a ready-made software. You can build your own software. And this you can see very clearly in a system that is blockchain-based. Let's take an example, Bitcoin, which is the biggest one. You can build your own client to access the network. network. You can analyze the network, you can build your own software to access the system. And there is no limit to that. If you build a software that breaks the system, you basically have won, because Bitcoin claims you cannot break it, even if you write your own software. In the old paradigm, you have an API-based system, so application protocol interface, where you are being granted access to the system, and you have an authority that guards over the way you use this data. So this shift of paradigm is the opportunity, and it's basically lying in new architectures of trust. So you don't have to have the permission of the Italian government to access the open data that is published by Banca Italia every year through the COP database. You can actually subscribe and make your own open data analysis. What do you do with it? It's up to you. If you're a company that provides bed and breakfast to people asking for it, you're going to capitalize on that relational value. If you are a company that organizes dating systems for people, you are going to capitalize on that sort of information. If you are a company that makes a spending review or a public sector institute that does spending review, you're going to look at things in that way. So I hope I haven't been too complex in describing this. There are really two different paradigms. Do our society needs this? We think yes. With Francesca Bria, we basically work a lot on this, we stress this aspect. We have multinational companies that are extracting data to make a business out of it. And this represents a problem. Here in Napoli, it's very clear, bed and breakfast is a problem, all the Airbnb business, because it can solve maybe a liquidity problem for the people that can actually rent out their house, but it hinders all possibilities of doing urban planning and actually have social housing and so on and so forth. In Amsterdam, where I live, it's a concrete problem of the city, and we are going to put a register of the bed and breakfast, because we don't want to become like Venice, a ghost city where people don't live anymore. So there are also social aspects to it. Another one, very simple, is Uber, that capitalizes building a seed of data in one place and capitalizes on the capacity of building the relationship between this data. Uber has no interest to give this data to any other taxi company around. They actually capitalize on this data, and they will use it at a high speed to overcome all sort of competition. And I think it's right for the people that have paid, lined up for years to have a license to be a taxi driver, to protest, because it's a completely illegal operation. An illegal operation that also the government is not ready, not even to address in what way is illegal, because information in private data is not regarded exactly as an asset. And maybe I conclude also with a comparison with the old paradigm. So far, innovation in technology and in industry in the last 30 years has been an operation of venture capitalists investing on the failure of a market. Here in Italy, we have Flixbus that has taken over completely the bus market, which is very important for us in the South. How? The first year, they made bus rides of €1. What was their plan? They had venture capitals, huge fundings, that actually put in the budget plan to make fail the industry, so to break it, to build a loss for the company until the whole industry would be broken and you are the only player. So my question is, was this really the promise of capitalism in the moment in which they envisioned a free market? Because at the end, the capital is not only a player in the market. It has so much capital that is able to break the market and actually injecting only one player and go to oligopoly. So perhaps the dream of the blockchain economies, which stays as a dream so far, is that of offering a level field, a single market where it's
fair.
Yeah. And here, yeah, markets again. Is there anything
like that? I want to hand over to Tiziana for her something to say about that.
Thank you, Gianluca. That was very interesting. And thanks to Adam as well for kind of this empirically based overview of data about the blockchain scene. So you started by saying that it's very obvious how the kind of the industry or the sector is dominated by market-based enterprises are actually oriented towards production of innovation for the market. And then you presented this kind of small section of blockchain for social progressive blockchain, which, however, you maintained and mostly about the production of discourse, really, with all these white papers, Medium platform as a kind of venue. So that's where I think that Jeroen's work and the Lecce project and the work Francesca has been doing as well is interesting, because it seems to me that they are working in a different direction. And this was quite clear from what he said. I didn't know about that, so I'm kind of catching up with it. Because what are my experience? I kind of followed the blockchain scene at the very beginning, and not really very beginning, let's say a couple of years later. Yes, when it kind of started to become a public thing, when Bitcoin became a successful cryptocurrency in trading in the market, and also other social experimentations started. So I was familiar with the ways in which exactly the kind of art world, for example, or even the kind of theory world coming from universities, or even places such as this, because La Silo has hosted events such as those organized by Fair Coop, the Fair Coin. We had Macau's Common Coin also being presented. So there was an emphasis on how you could use the blockchain to kind of better organize and make more visible the production of value that you already had in these kind of places. So there were expectations around the idea that blockchain systems could help places such as this to experiment in new ways to account for value production and distribute value. So we have to acknowledge the importance of what Jeroen did when he introduced the innovation of introducing the proof of stake, or the concept of the proof of stake. The idea, so you know that Bitcoin, I don't think that everybody is kind of up to speed, or even the beginning. So Bitcoin was based on data mining. It's a huge amount of energies wasted to mine Bitcoins. And this was supposed to provide a kind of a game that would work in allocated resources. So Jeroen's proposed the proof of stake, which was adopted by this experiment, which meant that you were issued these tokens, or these crypto tokens as a sign of value only if you demonstrated to be involved in a project.
We call it a social proof of work.
Social proof of work, yes. I remember the other term. I think also common coin, proof of stake, social proof of work. I think that's the model that Macau operated, yeah. Which was like, if you could show that you're putting a certain amount of hours in the project, then you get a share of the income collected through the various events organized by Macau as they organized in La Silo. So there was an attempt. Also, we hosted Immediations, a project that is based in Montreal. As Brian Massumi and Erin Manning's network, they were trying to think about a way to connect the blockchain technology to the idea of a kind of free university network, which could sustain itself, and where again blockchain could work as a means to produce value and allocate value. But this is what you're talking about, something actually quite different. And I think also what is different is that I think that this is the only case worldwide where you have public investment, so it's public money actually invested into developing these technologies with a vision of social change, which is closer to something that we might call social democracy, a social democracy, right? So it's the social, also in the sense of a socially democratic vision rather than a kind of neoliberal vision of social change. So a society where value is distributed more equally, and you know, people can organize themselves in different ways. And hence, I think what is interesting about what Major then is trying to do, and I think it's difficult as well, because I see that you started in Milazzo, for example, which is where you had your first boot camp, with this difficult relation with the community, which is that which historically has displaced society, right, as the locus of intervention. How historians, sociological historian or historians of the social, I'm thinking about people like Nicholas Ray, Nicholas Rose in the UK, have been very, it produces very interesting analysis of how the 1970s, 1980s, you had this shift from society, which presupposed addition of social change, which was systemic, and it was about the big picture and implied state intervention in a way that involved also an element of planning and the vision, has been replaced by an emphasis on community, which is a smaller entities which individual can identify themselves with, where they feel they have some kind of contact with. So I think there is a tension in what you're doing that I'm sure you must realize between this kind of big vision of kind of fighting venture capitalist funding with a venture social capital kind of enterprise to produce a kind of experiment that could eventually materialize into some kind of infrastructure approach to the key question of data. I think that's very innovative. Innovative is almost become a dirty word. You know, I think it's a worthwhile effort, right, in understanding how you can use the blockchain as a way to kind of hack into the main mechanisms of value extraction, economic organization, which is API-based cloud platform. So that's the vision that you have. So that's really interesting. And I look forward to hearing, you know, how this project, which I think is the first based in, I think you must have kind of had to put your point across to the European Union to kind of, you know, get this, how, you know, you're able to go beyond the limitation of kind of community-based project, which might replicate the kind of limits of the socially progressive. I found that the way you kind of turned around in the Ledger project, the kind of world that we do live in, which is based in corporate big data, such as closed, no privacy, you know, and I see that you're trying to kind of, it's almost a mirror image, but the opposite of that, so it's open, it's data corporate, so I can see how you kind of try to push something, you know, in a space, create a space where the vision could expand in something that can overcome the limitations of all these kind of small projects, which are becoming kind of marginal elements in the blockchain scene, and also they're not delivering because of the technical problems. I mean, most of these projects that we followed, they actually floundered on technology. They didn't, you know, the programmers ran with the code, you know, all these kind of things are becoming very, very common. And so kind of the scarce production of future scenarios have become detached from the kind of development. And that's a big problem. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Tiziano, for introducing these terms into the conversation. Because the questions that you're raising are, you know, sort of similar to my questions. And thank you for mentioning the example of the mediations project, which was, as Tiziana said, the project based in Montreal and directed by Massumi Manni, wanting to develop this idea of an autonomous university being autonomously funded through blockchain and holochain. That's what I remember from that project. And my idea from the sort of what stopped, in a sense, the project. I mean, I know that they are trying to go on, to move, but they are still a bit stuck. And my idea was that there were technical difficulties. There was a problem with finding, I don't know, programmers, the right technology. But there was also constantly a discussion about the difficulty of combining certain concepts and certain ideas about alternative ideas of value production in relation to concepts and to feelings that people had about what should be a common, how should value be considered in relation to other effective terms of value. I mean, how do you value the contribution of people to a project? How do you value the activities, the feelings, the work, everything that someone puts into a project? So there was a kind of difficulty trying to find the right kinds of technologies that could literally give sense and in a sort of way respect the idea of value that was shared by that kind of community. So there was a kind of how do you say it in English, of non-coincidence between the values, the ideas, the feelings, and the technological
tools.
Lack
of alignment.
Yeah, lack of alignment, because basically in the end, everything came up with the ideas of measuring, of data production, of finding ways to register value. And also another thing that I would like to introduce into the discussion, into the conversation, is the idea of monetization. So that was a problem, because there was this kind of non-coincidence between alternative ideas and alternative ways of thinking about money, and about how to measure value, and the necessity to face the project with the external, let's call it external economy. So the idea of monetization came as a problem into the project. And actually this resonates with other things that I've been writing lately about blockchain technologies. In particular, I'm thinking of the work of an Italian sociologist, Paolo Magalda, who is working about blockchain in relation to the sound production and consumption industries. And in an article, he basically writes, yes, there is a utopian vision where we see the blockchain as a kind of savior, allowing us to get more access to data, distribute, et cetera, et cetera. But then on the other hand, the kind of dystopic vision and dystopic way of seeing this is like seeing a world where everyone, or we all become not simply entrepreneurs of ourselves, but investors, shareholders. So this kind of problem of a particular kind of mentality, in a sense, of ideas behind the technology, where basically you become able to monetize almost everything, monetize relations, monetize, because data can be accessed and circulate so easily. But on the other hand, they can easily be monetized. And that's, in fact, the main aim, I think, of most projects. But this idea of the monetization of everything, of relations, of feelings, of emotions, of activities, events, then can actually come as a problem into the picture and into the development of particular projects that are more sort of alternative in the way in which they look at the economy, the economic relation. Yeah. So, yeah, my question is, how do you think of this idea? In a way, not to find a solution, but at least to take it into consideration.
Well, I'd rather ask Maria Cristina, because we share a project together, Common Fair, in which we worked, and this was precisely a problematic. The axiomatic approach to sense, to governance. So maybe you'd like to share.
Yeah, thanks. Well, thanks for the invite and for the introduction. Perhaps I should say something about the position from which I'm speaking. So I have a PhD in sociology, and my research areas are science and technology studies and participatory design. And so I've been working in the last 4 years in European projects. The first one with Jaromir. Also the perspective and position I'm speaking now here is that of someone who has been engaged in the field, in fieldwork, working with communities, also trying to design different kind of technologies. So I would share an issue, related to your point regarding the lack of practical applications on blockchain, because one issue and this issue is that of design, because I was thinking about this notion that the European Commission is using, that is a human-centric design or human-centric internet, on which also Project iLedger is based, and so the values that these kind of projects are trying to pursue at also Ledger is reliability and trust, and in order to give users and people, citizens, full control and ownership on their data. But I was precisely, and this is a question I would like to share, I was precisely wondering actually what are the practices and the people and the principle that inform this kind of human-centric approach and human-centric design approach and internet approach. Because I was looking at these videos on the bootcamp in Milazzo, in Sicily, on Ledger, and at a certain point there was Fred from Dyne saying, so the European Commission is using this notion of human-centric design, but there is lots of philosophies that sometimes doesn't really speak to one another. And so what Fred was saying is what we are doing here is precisely, you know, to try to find the practice, so the practical applications of this approach. And another participant in this bootcamp in Milazzo was saying, not coming here with the solutions, but hearing what are the conditions was the most rewarding experience of my life. And so my final question related to this issue of design is how can we combine this linear temporality of European projects, you know, because European projects have start date and end date, with this kind of circular temporalities of this kind of approach we want to pursue, right? And so how is it possible to put these two kind of temporalities together? And then, of course, there is also, I was also interested in discussing this issue of sustainability and the role of public subjects and funding agencies. But yeah, maybe I would save that for the next
interview. I prepared a presentation about the problem in the relation between the commons economy, the commons political projects and the blockchain. And then you asked about why do you think blockchain is not developing anything?
No, it's just a provocation.
Yeah, no, because it's truly related. So I think I will just start working and then things will happen. No, I think that the key word here is lack of alignment. You told it. If we observe the data that Adam showed us, we see that a lot of blockchain projects have problems in becoming sustainable, okay, or making profits. That we can calmly say it is the main incentive of economic development in this current phase, no? Because the technology gets developed if it's related to profit making. And in this sense, I think that, for example, Bitcoin, that is the most famous, iconic example of blockchain development, has been mainly driven by the fact that people wanted a different way to make profits by finance, by investing. Okay? And so when we ask ourselves about social projects dealing with blockchain or blockchain applications dealing with the commons, I think that it's obvious that if the current economy is in a state of deep crisis and even big capital don't know how to be sustainable, because that's another recurring theme in Adam Arvidsson production, that also the most starring startups of our digital economy like Uber and the other Airbnb are not sustainable at all, and they are the most brilliant example of digital economy, okay? That are centralized, they hoard data, and in the case of Google and Facebook, they make profits by selling personal information to the advertisers. So it's not a functioning economy. So it's true that blockchain is not producing anything useful yet, but despite the fact that it's very young as a technology, so I think that 10 years is not enough time to say that it's not useful to do anything. I think that commons-oriented application of the blockchain aren't emerged because they're not a profit incentive in developing them. And the blockchain standard, or the typical blockchain project is influenced by a capitalist market orientation. So you want to make the same thing of the last 20 years with the blockchain. So monetizing, profit making, et cetera, et cetera. I'm simplifying the discourse, but okay. And what's the point? So if you want blockchain for the commons, we have to find a way that is not related to profit seeking, okay. And I'm following since 2 years the Code Project and Ledger Project because, as Tizian said, they are the most important initiative in this sense. And what I find really interesting about those projects is that they bring the politics inside the technology, and they are very clear about it. And I'm also very happy that in this table we are five social scientists and one technician. It's a good point. Okay. So six. And here we have the real lack of alignment that explains why we don't have a blockchain application for the commons. That is that the communities that should converge to create a blockchain for social good simply don't know each other and don't speak the same languages and don't share the competencies. So if you have a global community of blockchain developers that are very market oriented and technical focused, in the sense that they all just into the technology. And then you have the social projects or commoners of leftist activists, as you want to call it, and that don't know anything about technology. I think it's obvious that we still don't have commons technology because we have to invest in making those groups communicate. And that's the what we are doing with our project, The Connective, that is mapping different ecosystems, different agents, and different also disciplines, mapping the opportunities of funding as a ledger, for example, or a public program or private program, and trying to create opportunities to develop this technology in a socially oriented way.
So blockchain and the commons, yes. I mean, there's, I of course going to use the opportunity to speak since I have a microphone and say some stuff, but I mean, just a comment on that, what you said. I mean, two comments really. I mean, on the one hand, of course, there's the, you said there is the capitalistic orientation, right? I mean, that's of course true. Or, I mean, a lot of people are going into this world to make a quick buck, right? So, you know, hodlers and so on, right? Okay. And then there's the more sort of radical, what Tiziana calls the red stack, right? I mean, the alternative architecture of the commons, et cetera, right? But there's also two other things I think that are very important. I mean, one very common orientation on blockchain ventures is what you could call, you know, anti-capitalist market orientation. It's like the whole Californian ideology. We want to have small scale companies that operate on transparent and egalitarian markets. And where basically we exchange craft gin for websites, something like that, right? Which is sort of an egalitarian. And that's a very, very important I mean, a lot of these sort of ventures are illuminated by that type of orientation. And then there's a fourth orientation, which I think we shouldn't forget, which is the Chinese despotic one, right? I mean, China has just now launched a cryptocurrency of its own, which is, you know, going to be a very interesting, and has, I mean, now with the coronavirus epidemic shown an astonishing ability to use not only blockchain, but a number of other types of big data technologies to sort of manage so the biopolitics of the disease in a very, very efficient and very, very ruthless way, in a sense, in a way that you can't really do in a situation where you have civil society, as we call it. So that's also probably an orientation that's going to be very soon. Okay, I'm just wanting now to open up a little bit for questions from the audience. You're very feel free to ask in Italian or intervene in Italian. All the panel speaks Italian, so we're basically just speaking English for the benefit of one guy who has now left the room. So we could also. Is he still there? He's just having coffee. Okay, right. So, per favore, fate i vostri interventi, domande, eccetera, in italiano. Siete molto benvenuti. Prego. Anche senza microfono, secondo me.
Secondo me non è vero che la blockchain non ha prodotto cose interessanti. La cosa più interessante che ha prodotto ultimamente, secondo me, è la DeFi, Decentralized Finance. Oggi ci sono progetti come MakerDAO che hanno prodotto monete che sono equiparabili al dollaro, sono stablecoin. Puoi convertire i tuoi soldi, i tuoi Ethereum o quello che è in DAI. C'è addirittura un progetto per cui accumuli interesse, c'hai un saving rate, c'è un 9% di saving rate sui tuoi depositi in DAI, sfido qualunque banca a darti questo. Quindi questa è veramente una cosa nuova, non serve KYC, non c'è anti-money laundering, non c'è niente. Quindi qualunque persona, anche in un'economia a rischio, può investire i suoi soldi in una maniera che è sicura e che funziona in tutto il mondo. Però questa cosa, e qui c'è la domanda, secondo me va direttamente contro quello che diceva Jeremy, questa idea che la blockchain in qualche modo è una cosa che livella tutto e si riparte, e in qualche modo si fotte il sistema e si prova a andare avanti. Secondo me è falsa profondamente, perché la blockchain è una struttura dati immutabile, completamente, il che vuol dire che se, per dire, io metto su uno smart contract che è una truffa e qualcuno ci casca, l'unica legge che conta è la legge di Zabo, cioè il codice è legge. Il risultato è che io perdo i miei soldi e non me la posso andare a piangere con nessuno. Questa è proprio il sogno dei liberisti. Questa cosa va totalmente contro l'idea che ci sia una struttura di governance che quando qualche cosa che è apertamente illegale accade possa essere cambiata, questa ci possa fare rollback. Non c'è niente per tutelare le persone da questo, assolutamente niente. E proof of stake, secondo me, è un'ulteriore prova di questo, perché proof of stake di fatto ti dice che più hai soldi, più fai soldi, perché più hai stake in un algoritmo di consenso, più è probabile che tu riesca a minare un blocco ottenendo una ricompensa. Quindi in realtà all'atto pratico, secondo me, la struttura dati di base della blockchain veramente presta il fianco a delle logiche di speculazione neoliberista come non ne abbiamo mai viste finora. È vero che i dati sono aperti, ma se noi non abbiamo una governance, un'alternativa seria alla legge di Zabo, tra 20 anni avremo veramente dei monopoli come non ne abbiamo mai visti prima d'ora grazie alla blockchain. E a quel punto che fai? Non saprai neanche chi possiede quelle monete, perché magari i wallets saranno anonimi. Quindi per quanto mi riguarda è una cosa, insomma... Quindi la mia domanda è, secondo te, come si risolve questa cosa?
Allora, prima di tutto penso che non sia... Noi quantomeno abbiamo cercato di esulare dall'uso finanziario della blockchain. Quindi negli usi finanziari come ci si creano delle dinamiche di accumulazione chiarissime. Il level field, che è la pseudo-neutralità di un contesto di scambio di valore, è un po' un'utopia. Però è una cosa a cui si tende anche per agenda politica dell'Europa, che ci ha finanziato. Quello che abbiamo cercato di tirare fuori concretamente con un progetto faro come Decode, ve lo presenterei perché risponde sia al tuo giusto dubbio,
sia a altre, altri punti che comunque aleggiano, che secondo me convergono tutti sul fatto che non c'è un'accessibilità a quello che veramente si decide. Cioè non c'è un'alfabetizzazione al codice. Nel momento in cui noi diciamo che il codice è legge, come ce l'hanno ripetuto in tanti finora, purtroppo non abbiamo né avvocati in grado di leggere, purtroppo per fortuna, di leggere il codice, né legislatori, persone che hanno effettivamente un background di governance, di buon governo, chiamiamolo così, sperandoci, che possono scrivere codice. Quindi che cosa diventa? Diventa uno strumento ormai a tecnocrazia, persone che comunque sanno il codice, sono le uniche che possono scriverlo e leggerlo. Questo problema l'abbiamo individuato chiaramente in Licode, su vari livelli, sia a livello operativo, perché dovevamo lavorare con varie, più di 13 partner, due città, Amsterdam e Barcellona, che dovevano capire quello che succedeva ai dati e ai programmi, sia a livello proprio più filosofico, diciamo, di inclusione, ma anche sociale di inclusione. Allora, la nostra operazione è stata quella di studiare sistemi avanzati in matematica, qui c'è un piccolo riassunto di come funzionano le curve ellittiche, che sono, come ben sai, l'innovazione più calda, diciamo, nell'ambito crittografico negli ultimi 10 anni, che ha permesso di fare cose molto più avanzate rispetto a quelle solite, cioè crittografia, fare messaggi segreti, crittografia, chiave pubblica, asimmetrica, fare firme digitali o certificati come quelli sul web. Ora siamo oltre, possiamo fare cose come multiparty computation, zero knowledge proof e tanti altri ammenicoli che stanno uscendo, che sono delle situazioni nuove, delle architetture informative nuove. Questa cosa è estremamente complessa per una persona che non ha un background in matematica. Come la rendiamo codice? Il più delle volte, ora vi faccio un viaggio visuale un po' nell'espressività che si usa in questi casi, il più delle volte se si lavora in matematica si comincia a esprimere un codice come quello, che è uno pseudocodice molto simile a quello che si usa nel programma matematica, in uso dai matematici, che è un codice che comunque assegna delle variabili e fa delle operazioni di moltiplicazione, di modulo, eccetera, che poi è espresso in linguaggio matematico in questo modo. Questa è la formula che usava il BlackBerry, che si chiama Implicit Certificate, è la signature che usava il BlackBerry. Queste formulazioni sono abbastanza difficili. Quello che abbiamo fatto in Decode è trasformarle in codice leggibile in linguaggio simile umano. Questo è un linguaggio di controllo fondamentalmente molto simile al Prolog. Il Prolog è un linguaggio di programmazione logica non Turing complete, quindi esegue queste frasi una a una, e se una non è vera si blocca in quel punto e ti dice perché. Dietro a questo linguaggio ci sono le stesse operazioni matematiche che avete visto, però sono espresse in modo funzionale da un linguaggio simile umano. Cosa succede? Che il programmatore o la programmatrice, nel momento in cui usa un linguaggio come Python, come JavaScript, come tanti altri linguaggi che possono essere in uso, mette una di queste frasi dentro una virtual machine che abbiamo creato e ottiene un risultato come la generazione di chiavi, la verifica di una firma, la generazione di una firma di un documento e così via. Perché l'abbiamo fatto? Perché effettivamente il problema maggiore è rendere le persone consapevoli di quello che fanno quando fanno girare un software. Nel momento in cui noi diciamo il codice è legge, dove la leggiamo? A chi ci rivolgiamo? Lo scarto è enorme. Nel momento in cui noi abbiamo una legge come la GDPR in Europa che dice che ci deve essere un Data Protection Officer responsabile di tutto il trattamento dei dati in un'azienda, quello che è successo in Italia, l'abbiamo visto, è che il Data Processing, il DPO, il più spesso è una persona con un background legale, non tecnico. È una persona che già lavora in azienda e avrà un aumento di 1000 euro sull'annualità solo per avere una responsabilità enorme. È una persona che ha un limitato accesso al dipartimento IT, quindi tecnologico, che gli può tradurre quello che veramente succede nei software,
è una persona in difficoltà, perché deve essere responsabile di come si trattano i dati in tutta l'azienda. E questo è solo per un'azienda che tratta dati. Pensiamo a un governo, a una città, a una municipalità. Quindi concretamente abbiamo tirato fuori questo progetto di conto, che è stato dichiarato progetto fallo dalla Commissione Europea, e che comunque, nelle parole di Francesca, è un tentativo di portare la crittografia alle masse. Perché crediamo che comunque la capacità di costruire nuove architetture di informazione non sia e non debba essere solo ad appannaggio di una tecnocrazia. Quindi vi propongo questa come possibile, se vogliamo, soluzione. E vi propongo anche un'altra domanda allora per il nostro dibattito, che io mi sono posto all'inizio. Perché cosa stiamo sviluppando tutte queste tecnologie? Perché se andiamo a vedere anche la narrativa delle intelligenze artificiali, del machine learning, sono del deep learning, mi piace molto questo termine, deep learning, è quasi uno sconto al comprendere quello che fa la macchina. È così deep, è così profondo, che noi non sappiamo neanche più i processi che hanno portato ai risultati, perché sono reiterati in modo abbastanza empirico e poco reversibile. Cioè, deep learning porta veramente questo concetto di irreversibilità quasi chimica dentro l'informatica, per cui io il risultato non posso più risalire agli ingredienti. E allora perché stiamo costruendo questi sistemi? Questa è una domanda filosofica. Li stiamo costruendo perché le macchine comprendano meglio noi, quindi processino i nostri dati, processino le nostre azioni, oppure stiamo cercando di sviluppare sistemi perché noi comprendiamo meglio le macchine, che sono sempre più pervasive e sempre più al potere?
Il primo
è veramente dove sta andando l'industria. Empiricamente sì, stiamo costantemente parlando di scenari in cui gli umani vengono sostituiti dalle macchine. Anzi, è un dialogo anche nel settore humanities che è veramente difficile da arginare. Veniamo sempre, ci chiedono sempre: ah, ma come farai quando ci sarà tutta questa disoccupazione? Ma chi l'ha detto che noi dobbiamo costantemente costruire sistemi che comprendano gli umani e li sostituiscano? Cioè, questa è una questione filosofica a questo punto. Perché non cominciare a comprendere una direzione di innovazione in cui noi comprendiamo meglio le macchine, avvantaggiandoci della loro velocità, ma comunque garantendo sempre una comprensione per gli umani, che si rifà anche a un progetto di governance molto chiaro in Europa, che è quello dell'open world, open world assumption. Nel momento in cui tu sei vittima di una legge, di un rating, di un sistema informatico che ti mette in una posizione, tu potrai sempre rivolgerti a un umano, a uno sportello, descrivere la tua situazione e richiamare un'eccezione laddove è giustificata. Quindi io vi pongo questa possibile soluzione e sono molto contento di sentire delle critiche, anche perché dobbiamo andare oltre. Ma questo è stato il tentativo, se volete, molto molto semplice, di alfabetizzare su quelle che sono le leggi, i processi che vengono automatizzati sempre di più.
To Giulio, or to the problem that Giulio raised, I think there are three approaches that I'm seeing in blockchain, pretty much to further the case of the commons, basically. And the first is pretty much what Macau and Common Coin are doing, or Common Pair are doing, basically accepting that it is tough, that the capitalist odds are against you, and using this technology basically as an organizational tool to connect different commons projects, but accept that the work people do will have to be unpaid because it's not producing exchange value in the end. And that it's not a very optimistic perspective, right? It's not going to be the revolutionary core that spreads like a wildfire. But at least it's somewhat substantial, I think. The second approach I see is trying to lure capital into investing into you or into your common cause, which other projects are doing, which is a very dangerous play with fire, because it is it's a strategy of lowering your defenses, luring it in. But once you have your defense lowered, takeover is around the corner. And that is what some more market-friendly commons approaches, like, for example, the common stack that we talked about, are doing. So it's the more libertarian take right, to introduce markets everywhere, market tools, markets coordination, and that will bring the post-capitalist future.
Well,
to me it seems like squaring the circle. The third approach that I see is what Economic Space Agency, for example, want to do, that is aiming at value itself, at the understanding of value, trying to come up with different understandings of value, with multidimensional value calculi. Yeah, basically reforming the notion of value, the concept of value, to have, for example, ecological value running parallel to economic value or social value. But then this brings the problem of how do you keep these different value accounts separate from another? How do you keep them from collapsing back into one, a one-dimensional economic value calculus? And that's really hard to do, because as soon as you allow for these other value tokens in the end to be traded against economic value, there you go, it compresses again into economic value. And this is, so far I have not really, the other alternative, you keep them separate, that could be just another fair trade stamp. Does that really change much? But, so up to now, I don't think that any of these strategies has brought the breakthrough, and maybe there is no breakthrough. Maybe there are. Most likely there is no breakthrough. the story of the easy magic pill is most likely just a fairy tale. But to Adams, maybe the fourth way, the market without capitalism. Well, is blockchain making Adam Smith's vision of a free market of myriads of small competitive actors without the possibility to constantly gain market power and abuse it? Is it maybe really that? And is that something that we would like to have? I think that is a question.
Well, you raised these points very succinctly, and I think it's very important to maintain a couple of theoretical distinctions, right? I mean, what I think is very important when we talk about these things is to separate markets from capitalism. And I mean, and that sounds a bit unorthodox if you're an orthodox Marxist, but if you're more of a Brodelian, then it's easier to do, right? Because then you could say that markets is something that's been around for a long time, and they can be more or less egalitarian, and they can be more or less concentrated, while capitalism is essentially an historic attempt to take over and monopolize markets. So in that sense, of course, the blockchain sort of the narrative, blockchain narrative of markets against capital sort of makes sense, not only from a point of view of sort of the Californian ideology of libertarianism, but it makes sense also from a point of view of actual structural developments right now, when sort of digital commons are enabling larger amounts of small scale, sort of low capital intensive market participation. Right? Of course, the question is whether is that anything that's sustainable or not. Of course, it's an entirely different question, but that's very much I remember there was this great quote by Giovanni Arrighi once. He said that it doesn't really matter how many capitalist companies or dispositions you have. You get a capitalist society to the extent that the capitalist class can command state power. So, and that is that sort of the way, right? It's the question, of course, is already there. It's the crucial question is the political level, the level of state power in some way, and how are markets regulated? Are they regulated such that there is space for a multitude of small-scale egalitarian actors, or are they regulated such that there is only space for human rights? I mean, that's the sort of the issue here. And that in turn opens up two new questions in a sense. The first thing is, how do you exit this sort of catch-22 moment? Because, of course, in order to get the state power necessary to regulate markets so that they can open up for a multitude of small-scale actors, there already needs to be a multitude of small-scale actors who have the interest and the power and the possibility to pressure the state to act in that way, right? So that's a catch-22. And the other question, of course, is who is the state, right? Because, of course, if we're talking about the old nation state, And it's not obvious that that's the agency that will be capable of implementing this type of regulation. So is the blockchain a technological substitute for state power? I mean, some blockchain enthusiasts seem to suggest that, and all this thing about code is law and all this sort of stuff, that you can somehow create these protocols that can never be changed and renameable, etc. And there seems to be a lot of faith in the blockchain community, and I use that dirty word, Tiziana, I never use community. Within the blockchain community, there seems to be like a lot of hope in this idea of a technological state power, where you can somehow substitute the state with code in some way. Right? So, yeah, that was just something I wanted to share.
If a smart contract gives me 100 million Ethereum, no nation state ever on the face of the earth can take that money away from me. Unless unless you hard fork, but then unless again the whole community of Ethereum.
No, it wasn't a community. The vote was false. There is a research by Ellen that proved that the vote of the hard fork.
Yeah, but you still have to convince somehow the miners to be on your branch of the fork.
Just Italy couldn't. It's enough.
I don't think it's enough today.
One technocrat could fork.
Well, that's even more fucked up, though, right? Yes. I mean, I don't agree with that, but admitting that it's true, it's even worse.
Yeah.
So that's the problem, you know, and that's why, I mean, you say people have faith in this. I am totally shitting my pants about this. This is like the worst thing that can happen, in my opinion. That's just, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think we'll start from this side for the concluding remarks. So please, Giulio.
No, I wanted to answer to Felix. Collegate to your question, and this is a panel about blockchain, so I cannot say that blockchain is not the point, but blockchain is not the point of this gigantic political problems we are talking about. But dealing with blockchain more specifically and the new value systems, because of that we are talking about, we are the scenario is like this: you have capitalism that is in crisis and cannot develop more profitable economic models. So we want an alternative model, being it the commons or neo-feudalism or what it is. And in this new model, blockchain can help you to better manage and quantify value in a system, okay? Because you know that with the token economy, you can basically decide and code how do you want to attribute value in a system. So I decide that a hug is like a meal. You can eat 1 meal if you give me a hug. I'm saying stupid things. And so you can elaborate sophisticated system of value. But beyond the plethora of technical possibilities that you can develop with blockchain, I think that there is a way more important discourse about the political economy underlying the system in which this blockchain is developed, no? Because I think that after this period, there will be a lot of years needed to imagine and develop a new economic system that is also a new monetary and value system. And in these big struggles to develop a new economy, blockchain will have a place in the sense that it will enable some processes or some technical layers of this struggle, okay? You have a new economy, new logics, new politics, new law, which may be some law is code, some law is the normal law, and then you have blockchain. But I don't think that just observing blockchain and what it can do is enough to imagine the next system or the commons economy, as you wish. And I think that, the idea of a monopoly with blockchain is much worse than without, because as every technology, you can do good things and bad things depending on how you look it. And blockchain can be very efficient in controlling things. Yeah. But that's not the problem. I think we are in a very, very bad situation also without blockchain. So yeah, it can. Yeah, but yeah, it can be worse. But I don't think it's the main preoccupation. Okay. I am not very responsible to it.
Yeah, so I was just wanted to contribute a couple of other ideas with respect to what Jaromil said before. Because first of all, I guess that you mentioned previously a very key word, also very popular in STS, that is translation. And you were referring to this technical translation that is quite important, very, very important, especially when you work with on community-based level, with collectives, with groups, so with citizens. And so we have seen that also in the Common Fair project, that people sometimes, that also the activists and people more engaged, do not really have time to study and to engage in this sort of understanding of technical language. But I would also add that it is also important to build up this relational translation in the sense that in order to get people engaged, you need to build trust with people and with citizens. And so in this respect, I would also highlight the important role of, let's say, what we can call them intermediaries. And this is a model that we try to develop in the Common Fair projects, with basically giving money to an NGO association, and in Italy was the Basic Income Network, because they had, they already had trust with of the participants and citizens we wanted to work with. So I think that this technical translation should go with the relational one and to the building of trust relations with research participants. And the second and last thing I wanted to contribute also concerns your question. So you said why we should build up further technology. And I would stop there. So why we should build up further technology, full stop, question mark, and full stop. In the sense that also this question, in a way, resonates with the second issue I wanted to share in this debate, that is the issue of sustainability. And I'm talking about the sustainability of these projects, because we know that after 3, 4, 5 years, they end. And sometimes this period is not enough to achieve these very ambitious objectives and goals that also projects like Ledger want to achieve. And so my question also in this respect is, what is the role of, and so we were talking about the role of public actors, the role of the market, but in this case, in the case of Ledger, what is the role of public actors and funding agencies that in this case they overlap, because there is this is the European Commission, in actually ensuring the sustainability and the maintenance of these projects, rather than issuing other calls to build up further and new technology. And also in saying this, I'm thinking about this US-based also academic and activist organization called The Maintainers. It is made up of STS scholars, media scholars, activists, historians of technology. And they focus on precisely this role of designing technology and innovation in terms of repair and maintenance of previous technology and infrastructures.
Can I interject and I pass you the... Of course. It really resonates, and I think one main thing, I've been working myself in cybersecurity, and I'm really happy I don't anymore. But this is a principle in security, complexity, but not only. So to lower complexity, you achieve better security. Simplicity achieves better security. And if you think in an organization, who works longer in an organization? organization is excluded by innovation. Mm. At that point, you have less security and less trust in the organization. Mm. A 60 years old person that is close to retirement, but knows very well how to use all the Excel sheets, has a career and a trust of the colleagues in a company. If you substitute this company, then this person that is doing the budgeting of that company, with a new software that perhaps is built by a third party, it's more efficient, it does everything automatic, but you don't know it actually, you are at loss of security, of trust, and integrity. So intergenerational compatibility, so to include different generations of expertise within an organization, is very important. And this is, you know, it's not only a matter of diversity, it's really a matter of integrity in your organization. You cannot just get rid of people that are aging out and their experience just because you have a new software. And I hope it clicks with the point you're making. You cannot just like build new technologies just like, you know, because you live once.
Yes, thank you. I was thinking about lately, thanks to Luca, I was here, but also some other meetings I've been doing. I've been kind of rethinking again about the utopian socialist, right, from the 19th century, which is the group that Marx set up his theory against. And I thought that what you described as the kind of anti-market, it really carries a lot of that ethos. So the idea was that capitalism was bad even then, and that you replace it by building small communities, small experiments with technology, and then you might have this production of moral discourse. Sorry?
4 years
back. Yes, kind of. And Marx's point was that you cannot just build small communities where everything works. You need a war machine because there is an enemy. And it's very well organized and it's very active. So you need to carry out this kind of war of opposition, the war of maneuver, the Russian Revolution, where you have the avant-garde. And you have this sudden revolution. It's not a model that works for complex societies. So you need actually continuous war opposition to kind of counter other approaches. And this involves a translation across different domains. So you cannot have a kind of purity where you stay in opposition and you never engage with electoral politics, with European funding. You need to be where the war opposition is conducted. And because otherwise, again, you fall as soon as you meet the limits, you fall. Well, this thing about the commons, right? I know that the Red Stack piece that I wrote in 2013, so like 7 years ago, is circulated quite a lot. And of course, you know, it's a bit dated now because at that time, there was still the feeling that after 2008, you know, there was an opening, and the opening kind of closed, seemed to have closed quite quickly. But still, some of the idea, I still stand by it, because I think that we spent quite a lot of time, you know, people who looked at the evolution of power, dispositives of power, such as the ones that we're living in now, which is the market economics, neoclassical economics, you know, the whole rationality of government, which we hear again and again and again, you know, that rationality was developed over time. And then it was fought in very bloody battles, which, for example, targeted economics department, which had become like the theology department of contemporary universities. You only have one school. You know, there were like epistemological battles, so there were thought, there were technological battles. And they all started also with ideas. So you gotta have some kind of an idea, a project, a vision. And the notion of infrastructure has been quite central to contemporary studies of software, which pointed out the importance of the kind of the construction of infrastructures as something that constitutes kind of stack, as Benjamin Bratton called it, this kind of system where the different parts are not neatly fitting together, but they're like also a little bit disjointed. And in this sense, if you call this law, it's not law in the sense of the Ten Commandments, or even in the sense of the book of, you know, kind of book of law where you have some clear rule. It's law as if law was like composed of millions of lines, millions, billions of lines of code, and they all sometimes are clashing with each other. You know, sometimes they are feeding back into each other. So it's not deterministic. It's not the kind of deterministic kind of law, but it's in some position it can be. But it's a huge sprawling system. I mean, if you think about platforms like Facebook, they don't even know their own code anymore. It's become this huge machine. Again, reporting what is being written about by people who are working on computation. So there's all this writing and computation, you know, and logics. We all, our friend Luciana Paris is working on this notion of critical computation, for example. There's a lot of emphasis on non-conscious cognition. So this idea that both machines are learning to know us in a non-conscious way, and we're also learning to know machines in a way, in a kind of non-conscious way. So the way in which you kind of learn to interact with the machine is not cognitive in the higher or aware. So the level in which you are learning to know the machines, you have the need of the kind of work that you're doing, so the translation, the interfaces, but also there's a much more kind of intuitive knowledge of machines, which is also developing, which is also an interesting point of view.
It's a clashing with the concept of a blockchain, because in a blockchain, every calculation needs to be deterministic.
That's the
blockchain works. So you publish your computation and you claim that everyone, given the same input, will be able to replicate the same output. And so it's validated. So all computation is deterministic and therefore reversible. And this is a clash. Now we are individuating. So I'm curious to read more about this unconscious.
More importantly, you can try. You can build this unconscious thing by trying. But on the blockchain, you have to pay to do anything. So you can't try stuff as much as you want. You literally have to pay for computation. I can learn to use Google just doing 3 days straight of searches, but I can't with Bitcoin. It's a lot of money.
So to conclude, I would like to go back to the question of language, actually, because I think this is something that came out in Giulio's remarks when you spoke about the different groups collaborating and working together, and maybe not all speaking the same language. And then it also came out in what you described as a kind of translation in terms of languages. So I think that an important issue in relation to working with technologies, not using technologies, but working with them, is the issue of language. So finding the right language to do that, that can be a language that can actually translate and help communication between different groups and between humans and machines. So the issue of language, I think it's an important one. And so when we speak about language, it's also about how to create and invent languages, because together with the use and creation of machines, of technologies, how we use them, how we perfect them, how we interpret them, it's also about how we create different words to work with these machines. So language is always an issue of creation, invention of new languages. I think this is important because, for example, if we think of the word sustainability, and what do we want to do with this word? Do we want to replicate the same sense in which often sustainability is now used? For example, I recently read about BlackRock and the CEO of BlackRock talking about the new capital in the future being only sustainable capital. And so this word sustainability apparently is becoming a word that is circulating from the big corporations up to the, you know, our projects and the ideas we are talking about. So if the same word circulates, maybe it's the case to try also to differentiate the language and not just say, okay, but we use the same word but in a different sense, but maybe try to find a new word. So in relation to the invention of language, I would like to conclude with also another article that I recently read by a sociologist of data, critical data sociologist. Her name is Deborah Lupton, and she talks about data as a companion species, which is a very very interesting idea that I think she takes from this other interesting thinker that is Donna Haraway. Some of us might know her, mainly for her cyborg idea, the cyborg manifesto. So anyway, so Deborah Lupton talks about data as companion species. I mean, this might seem just like a little thing, like a very creative, inventive thing, but it's actually very important because it, you know, it changes things totally if we work with technologies and with data, thinking of them as objects to, you know, to manipulate, to control, to possess. So data, for example, like is happening in China, that we use to control people or to control data themselves. But it's a totally different thing if we think of data and work with them as companion species. They suddenly become something to take care of, which today, in the days of the virus, I think is becoming an important thing. So how to take care of people, but how to take care of data, because it's something that is becoming vital today in terms not only of survival, but of well-being. So words are important.
That's an excellent conclusion to this workshop. Words are indeed very important. And thank you very much for all these important words that you have uttered. And thank you much for coming. I thank the panel for being here despite virus emergency, etc., for braving the regulations and coming here. And I hope you spero che avete avuto qualcosa da questa serata che è stato, diciamo, di comune interesse. Ringrazio il panel per essere venuti.
Grazie Luca.
Invito tutti a riunirci per l'aperitivo in un bar qui nelle vicinanze. Grazie.